No, for that you should turn off on your camera again.
Right. So welcome everyone, and it's our pleasure to have Artem Chernikov from UCLA speaking on distalled invalid fields and related structures.
All right. Thank you very much for the introduction, and it's nice to be given a talk in this virtual seminar. So. I will talk indeed about things around distalled evolute fields. This is joint work with Matthias Aschenbrenner, Alan Garrett, and Martin Ziegler. Actually, I have given a version of this talk a while ago in Münster. So, but there's something different about this time. So hopefully it will be, even if you were there, it would still be something new. So let me begin just with stating the main theorem. And there will be some words in it, which will be explained afterwards. So assume that we have K, a Hinsilian valued field. How do we view it as a structure? So we view it as a structure in K in the language of rings with a separate predicate for the evaluation ring. Okay, that's it, nothing else. So the usual language, where we denote its value group by gamma, and its residue field by little k, as usual. Okay. Then we have the following equivalence. K is distal, respectively, has a distal expansion, if and only if the following happens. Well, the following two conditions hold. So the first condition is that K, the field itself, capital K, is equicharacteristic zero. Or K is characteristic zero. And the residue field is finite. Okay, so one of these two things happens. And in the case, when K is finite, we also have that necessarily the evaluation is finitely ramified. So, and O is finitely ramified. Let me remind what this means. So this means that every interval of the form zero, the valuation of n is finite for all n greater or equal than one. Okay, so, right, so again, so either k is equicharacteristic zero, or k is characteristic zero and has finite residue field, and is finitely ramified. Oh, and probably I should start by saying that K be an infinite Hinsilian field. Item two is that both the residue field and the value group are distal, respectively, have distal expansions. Okay, so this theorem can be viewed as a kind of Axe-Kochan-Yershov type characterization of distality, or respectively existence of distal expansions for Hinsilian valued fields. Whenever I say distal expansion, to be careful throughout the talk, by distal expansion, so we say that a structure has a distal expansion if its theory is interpretable in a distal structure. Okay, so we have the slightly extended notion of expansion. And so I'm not saying that the same structure can necessarily be extended sorry, the same function necessarily has a distal expansion, but that there's some other model of this theory of the structure, elementary equivalent to it, which has a distal expansion. So at the level of the theory, it has a distal expansion. Okay?
Wait, and again, distal expansion means it's interpretable in something, not in the same, not the same structure.
The theory is definable in a distal structure. In, sorry, the theory is definable in distal theory.
Interpretable or definable? Wait, interpretable?
That doesn't matter because stability is preserved in TEQ.
Okay.
Okay. Now, I will define the stability in a minute, by the way. So let me just say a couple of comments about this.
Oh, wait, another question is that what if you change the language of K? That's like three or four languages
yes,
possible,
K,
right?
Little k and gamma are allowed to have additional structure. And the yes, there are different languages, but all the ones which are bi-interpretable with this, so RV language, I mean, well, I'll discuss languages also. So you can, in, alternatively, this works in the RV language, but with
the
angular component, not necessarily.
Expansion of the group center?
Excuse me?
The expansion of the field is related to the expansion of the group, or you just say there exists some expansion?
So the statement is as written. But yes, the expansion will be produced from an expansion of the little k and gamma. Okay, so I need to move on past the main theorem, I guess. Okay, so this is the statement. Let me make a couple of remarks. So, of course, this can be viewed in some sense as lying within the context of Scheler's conjecture. So the interesting feature is that some things become easier, actually, if we focus on distality instead of an IP, because as we will see in a minute again, so infinite fields of positive characteristics should disappear from the picture. But interestingly, there is a new feature, namely that distality is not preserved under redux. So we actually have to be more careful about definable sets in various situations. Some arguments around an IP don't go through. Let me also mention that there is a paper by Sylvie Anscombe and Franziska Janke, where they prove a similar Axkochin-Yershov type statement for Hensilian and IP fields. Yeah, so there is some parallel, but okay. All right, so this is the main statement of the main theorem. So my idea for the talk is to explain some ideas that go in. There are several different ingredients, and then maybe mention some related questions and problems. All right? Okay. So first I should say some generalities about distality. So this for this part, we don't say anything about fields for a minute, just general, what is distality, yeah? What are the definitions? So let me summarize a bunch of things around distality with this one single fact. So we assume that T is a complete theory. And as usual, bold M will be a monster model for T. So then we have the following equivalent conditions on the theory. So the first one says that for any indiscernible sequence, I, which is given by some tuples AI, indexed by the rational numbers, and which we assume the sequence to be non-constant, and any tuple B, if we look at the sequence AI, but without the element in the middle, so without A0, so if this sequence happens to be indiscernible over B, then the whole sequence is indiscernible over B. Okay. So this is the first condition on the theory. So pictorially, we have a sequence like this. This is a zero, this is a I, and we have some additional tuple B. So if we are indiscernible without this one point in the middle, then automatically you're indiscernible adding this point in the middle as well, okay? So the first condition, the second equivalent condition on the theory is the existence of strong honest definitions. So T has strong honest definitions. This is a form of informed definability of types over finite sets. So for every formula phi of xy with two groups of variables x and y, so we have a partition formula phi of xy. So for every such formula, there exists some other formula psi of x and let's say y1 through yn, where all these yi's are just copies of the variable y, such that if I'm given a finite set of parameters corresponding to the variable y in the sort for the variable y, and I'm given a tuple in the sort corresponding to the variable x, then there exists, excuse me, there exists some choice of parameters b1 through bn in B, such that first, this tuple A satisfies this formula psi with the parameters B1 through Bn plugged in. And this formula psi of X B1 through Bn isolates the type of A over B, the phi type of A over B. Okay, and I also should be careful, I should say for all B, so that the cardinality of B is at least two. Otherwise, we might need finitely many formulas to do this job. Okay, so so there is this uniform way to isolate types over phi types over finite sets. Okay, so this is the second condition. And the last equivalent condition is the so-called definable strong Erdős-Hajnal property. So what is it saying? It's saying that if we are given any formula phi of xy with two groups of variables again, then there exists some positive real number epsilon and two formulas psi 1 of x z1 and psi 2 of x of y z2, which satisfy the following. For any pair of finite sets A in the sort for x and B in the sort for y, there exists some parameters which we can plug into these two formulas. So there exists some ci in the sort corresponding to the variable zi, such that the set, the subset of A cut out by psi 1 with the parameter c1 has size at least epsilon times the size of A. Similarly, the set cut out by the formula psi 2 of c2 out of B has size at least epsilon times the size of B. And the pair of these two sets is homogeneous in the sense that either we have that psi 1 of AC1 times psi 2 of BC2 is contained in the set of all pairs satisfying the formula phi, or it is disjoint from it. So okay, so either contained, let's say, or it is contained in A times B, but without the set of those pairs which satisfy phi. Okay, so this is a Ramsey, kind of a very strong Ramsey theorem. So given any binary relation, phi, definable binary relation, if we look at any pair of finite sets, then there must be a pair of two subsets of those sets. Yeah, so maybe I draw it like this. So given any pair AB, we can always find some definable, some pair of sets subsets inside them. which are moreover defined or cut out, relatively defined by two instances of this fixed formulas, psi 1 and psi 2, such that either we have all edges between them in the sense of phi, or we have none. Okay? So these three statements are equivalent for a theory. So let me comment on this. So one is the original definition of distality by Simon, or rather one of the most, well, one of the basic equivalents of it. The equivalence of one and two is proved by Pierre and myself. And the equivalence to three is proved by Sergei Starchenko and myself. Okay, so we have these three different ways that all characterize distality. To be clear, this is a subset of an IP. So any of these conditions implies an IP. And the idea that in some sense it captures the extreme case of unstable in IP theories. So you probably know, but let me just mention. So examples of distal theories, sorry, I didn't say so. If a theory satisfies any of these conditions, we say that T is distal.
Yeah. Artem, let me stop you for a second. Condition one, it's global, but condition two or three are local on formulas. Okay.
Yeah.
So two. Okay. If you have two locally, just for a formula phi, do you get three? If you do the local version.
I need to look at the proof. I mean, you might have to modify the formula a bit. Maybe. I mean, you will have to define one in a meaningful sense, right? So you'll have to talk about phi definability or something.
Yeah, no, I don't care about one, just two and three.
Oh, okay.
Two and three are local, one is not.
Probably not literally, but I think, one needs to. I'm not sure if it just holds for the same formula phi itself immediately, okay. But maybe it's not far from it. Yeah, it should be quite local, the equivalence.
Artem, do you need an IP assumption for T?
No, you don't need. All of any of these assumptions implies an IP. So one, or, well, and so we know the equivalent, yeah? So let's say one implies an IP.
Okay.
Or two or three, either. Yeah, it's easy to see from two, for example, it shows that there are few phi types. Since each type is given by, determined by a finite tuple, you can see that there are few phi types. So, but it's also not hard to check using one or whatever. Okay, so we have this. Maybe I should also remark that three, once you have either of these conditions, then three holds for generically stable measures instead of this intersections with finite sets, which can be viewed as counting measures with finite support. This holds for arbitrary generically stable measures. And all right, I was giving some examples. So examples of distal theories are or minimal theories, or weakly or minimal, or quasi-weakly or minimal, whatever the p-adics, and we'll see today some more examples. Yeah. Okay. Another remark is that in either of these conditions, so let's say, for example, in one, without loss of generality, we can assume that either AI or B is a singleton. So we can't assume both of them to be singletons simultaneously. So to verify distality, it's enough to have this property in the situation when either the elements of the sequence are singletons or the elements or B, the tuple B is a singleton. All right. So I want to comment a bit more about distality. So I want to mention a lemma from our paper, which is actually quite useful if you've ever worked on this kind of preservation results. And I think it's, so it would be useful, I think, to discuss it. It might seem a bit technical, but somehow it's actually at the core of many of the arguments. So the proposition is the following. Assume that T is an IP structure theory, and assume that D is an empty set definable set. So that the induced structure is distal. With the induced structure on D being distal. So what does it mean? What is this induced structure? So this means that we look at view D as a structure with a bunch of predicates where every predicate R is of the form some power of the predicate D, some power of the set D intersected with some empty set definable relation E, let's say. Yeah, so we have to add all such, we have to name all such things that can be cut out from D. So this is the induced structure on D. The lemma gives you ways to lift distality from a given set to somehow to the whole structure. So there are two claims, which are both phrased in terms of the first equivalence of the definition that I just gave. So in terms of indiscernible sequences. So the first one says that for any B anywhere in the structure and an indiscernible sequence, AI indexed by Q, which is contained in D. Yeah, so the first case we have a tuple is anywhere in the model, in the monster, the sequence is inside the predicate D. If we have that AI without the zeroth element is indiscernible over B, then I is indiscernible over B. So we have distality somehow localized to on a predicate, and from this we want to conclude that the definition of distality is satisfied also when we allow things, some things outside of the predicate. Yeah, so we look at these interactions. So this is actually the easy one, and two is considerably more trickier. This is like one, but with the roles of the variables exchanged. So for any I anywhere in the structure now, and B, a tuple from D, the same claim. So if AI without the zeroth element is indiscernible over B, then I is indiscernible over B. Okay, so we have these two statements. So as I said, two is considerably harder. So to, we prove it by adapting actually Pierre-Simon's proof of reduction of distality to singletons, the one I mentioned on the previous slide. There are two important corollaries of this. So corollary one, which is quite useful, is that if we have that the whole structure is an IP, and we have an empty set definable, so set D definable without parameters, so that the induced structure is distal. And if it happens that the whole structure is contained in the algebraic closure of D, then M is also distal. So structure is distal.
Artyom, about the proposition, do you think it's likely that two could be true? I mean, that this could be true without NIP?
I doubt.
Okay.
Well, maybe with local NIP assumption or something. But you need some connect. You need some kind of weak stable embeddedness to be able to connect the tuples, right?
I agree.
Okay.
Definitely, if this is a singleton, for example, then it seems like this would be always true. And but okay, no, never mind. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Okay. So this is a useful thing. So it somehow tells you that finite covers of distal sets are themselves distal as long as the whole thing is an IP. And this implies, so this is not hard to prove using two. And the second corollary is that T is distal if and only if TQ is distal, as I already mentioned. So it's funny because I think it's a well-known fact, but apparently there's no actually correct published proof of it. So at least if I understand correctly, so the proof in Pierre's book is has a gap. For example,
there is a pure proof there. I thought it was an exercise there.
Oh, maybe it's okay. There's something, I don't know. Anyway, so it follows from this, for example. So it is certainly true. So it's actually, yeah, a small exercise to check yourself to see how corollary two follows from one. Okay. All right. So this is all I wanted to say about general distality. So the point is that this kind of lemmas are very useful, as you can imagine, once we have some stable distal sort, like the residue field or gamma. So this kind of lemmas should be useful for lifting distality from this auxiliary source to the whole structure. Okay. All right. So the next thing, I want to say some general words about distal fields and rings. Okay. So very important fact for us here is something that follows, well, something we proved with Sergei, is that if K is an infinite field definable in a distal structure, in a distal theory, then K has characteristic zero. Okay, so why is it true? So the reason for this is in fact incidence combinatorics. The reason for this is that the quantifier-free definable incidence relation between points and lines on the plane in the algebraically closed in FP-ALCH doesn't satisfy the strong Kardosh-Heinel property. Yeah. So even without definability of pieces, it's just not possible to find homogeneous pairs of linear size in general. So this falls from direct calculation in finite fields, and so lifts to FP-ALCH, and then combined with the result of Kaplan, Scanlon, and Wagner, we know that every NIP field, infinite NIP field of characteristic P, contains FP-ALCH. Okay, and the relation is the incidence relation is quantifier-free definable, so it still doesn't satisfy strong Kardosh-Heinel in K, and so it cannot have a distal expansion by what we saw. Since any relation definable in distal structure must satisfy strong Kardosh-Heinel. So it's a bit, it's a slightly funny argument, goes through finite combinatorics somehow. Okay. Actually, a curious related problem, I don't know if this holds for type definable fields. So assume K is only type definable in a distal structure. Does this imply that K has characteristic zero? Yeah, of course, the issue for this is that this argument with containing FP-ALCH, it's also not known. So we don't know if type definable fields in an IP series are arbitrarily closed, for example. Yeah, oh, yeah. Okay. So this is concerning fields. So this will be a very important fact for the main theorem. Let me mention something about
generalization. Is this the only obstacle? If you knew that, then you would get it?
I think that would be enough here, but okay. It needs to be checked. So now a proposition about generalizing these two rings. Okay, so we see that fields all have to have characteristic zero. What about rings? So this result is actually not hard to generalize using a little bit of ring theory to show the following. Suppose R is a unital ring, so with multiplicative identity, without zero divisors, definable in a distal structure. Okay, then the characteristic of R is also equal to zero. What is the characteristic of a ring? So this is the smallest n greater or equal than one, such that n times one is equal to zero, or zero if there is no such n. Yeah. So we show, so we see, observe that this generalizes from fields to rings without zero divisors, and this assumption.
Wait. So how does it? How does it proof work? It's the same or?
No. What do you mean? You reduce it to field, but you need to use some ring theory for this.
Okay.
Okay. And so, however, the assumption that there are no zero divisors actually cannot be dropped. So this is also, sorry. So the other proposition, no zero divisors cannot be dropped. So we have an example. The example is actually given by looking at an abelian group of the form fp to the q. So we look at Hund product. Okay, and then this has a distal expansion by naming the valuation, the natural valuation on it. And then we can take the ring to be something like fp times times. So if this is h, can take fp times h. This gives a commutative ring, unital, of course, of characteristic p. But it is definable in distal structure. It's a reduct of a distal structure. Okay, so this shows that the assumption, the limitation of how far you can go with this. Also, let me mention that in some work in progress with Pierre, we show that all abelian groups have distal expansion. Okay. All right. So this is some general observations about distal fields and rings. Okay. So, and one more observation that we will need. So this actually another corollary of the Kaplan's Kanon-Wagner theorem, which was pointed to us by Franziska Janke, is that so fact that if we have a valued field KO, which is an IP, and the residue field is finite, then K is then the evaluation is finitely ramified. Yeah. So then V is finitely ramified. Okay, so this is general observation. And so if we combine everything stated on this page, we have the following. So the conclusion is that if a valued field has a distal expansion, then K O is finitely ramified. And the residue field has characteristic zero or is finite. Okay. So using some of the general results, we reduce to this situation. Okay.
Do you really need, even in a residual characteristic zero case, that the ramification is finite?
No, in the characteristic zero case, you don't need any. In the equicharacteristic zero case, you don't need anything, I think.
That's right.
Yeah, right, yeah. Okay, okay. So now returning to the theorem. So we need to reduce to RV, right? So the first step of the proof of the theorem is the reduction to RV, to the RV sorts. So I have to say a couple of words what it is, yeah? So we assume that we have a valued field so that the characteristic of the field is zero. So we are in this case from now on. So we have this RV source associated to it. So if I have some value, so non-negative delta in gamma, we can consider the corresponding ideal M delta, which consists of all elements in the field such that the valuation is greater than delta. So it's an ideal in the evaluation ring. Of course, there's a maximal ideal which corresponds to M delta, sorry, to M zero. And then one defines the corresponding RV structure, RV delta, where you look at the field K and you take the quotient by one plus this ideal M delta. So you have the natural map, the projection map So K to RV delta. Okay, and again, we write RV, just RV to denote RV zero. Okay. Now, this RV zero gives rise to a short exact sequence of abelian groups. So we have the multiplicative group of the residue field, have RV cross. So this RV without zero, we have mapped to the value group to zero. So what are the maps? So this this is the map which is denoted VRV. So this is just the map induced by the evaluation on K. And this is the map, well, this is just the so if we have an element O, A in the evaluation ring without, but outside of the maximal ideal, then the corresponding class in RV star only depends on the coset, right? On the coset A plus M. So this induces this map. This is not all structure that we need on this source. So there's also a partial addition that is induced on RV. So we also define this, we have this ternary operation on RV delta, which is like the induced graph of addition, but it's only partially defined here. So it holds if and only if we have some XYZ in the field, such that R is equal to RV delta of X, S is equal to RV delta of Y, and T is equal to RV delta of Z, and X plus Y is equal to Z. Yeah. So the usual partial addition induced. And so now the RV structure, we define it in two cases. So in the case when the residue field has characteristic zero, we just take RV zero with the corresponding multiplication and partial addition, right? And we take it to consist of all the sorts RV delta with the corresponding operations and the maps that go between, connect these different RV sorts. So we have to look at all gamma greater or equal than delta. And we only care about the ones which contain the powers, the valuations of, sorry, which are the valuations of the powers of P in the case when the characteristic of the residue field is P. Okay, so this is the auxiliary RV structure. Now note that this is, all of this is interpretable in the valued field just with the predicate for the relation ring. So we are not actually introducing any new sets if we add the sorts for V to our structure. And so an important result, so it has of course prehistory in the work of Bessarab and others, but in this form it's due to Flanner, is that if the characteristic, as we already mentioned, so the characteristic of the whole field, capital K, is zero, and the field is Hensilian, this implies that the field satisfies it has quantified elimination down to the RV source. So K has QE. KO has QE down to the RV sort. So the only, every form is equivalent to one where we only quantify over the RV sorts. And this, all this RV structure is fully stably embedded. Right? So there are no new definable sets induced on the structure apart from the field, apart from the ones which you can define in the structure itself already. Also remark is that both of this hold resplendently. So holds resplendently So this means that if we may assume that there's some additional structure on the RV sort, we can put whatever additional structure we want on the RV sort, we still have this relative quantifier elimination and stable embeddedness. Okay, so this is one of the standard quantifier elimination results for Hinsilian valued fields. Now, using everything we have discussed so far, we can, one can analyze indeterminable sequences and the structure. And all these previous results about finite ramification, etc. So we can reduce, we can show the following proposition, which shows that the question of distality reduces to the RV sort for a Hinsilian field, okay? So we have that KO is distal, has distal expansion, if and only if, is finitely ramified, and the RV structure is distal, or respectively has distal expansion. Okay, so so our question, the main theorem, completely reduces. We can completely reduce it to understanding the situation for the RV sort. Okay, so. And note that we cannot work, for example, with angular component, etc., because distality is not preserved under redux. Yeah, so we don't actually want to introduce any new sets, or we don't want to forget any sets. So this is an important point. We really have to go through RV somehow. Okay, and so the next step is the reduction from RV to the residue field and the value group. Okay, so let me just state immediately the proposition is that it does our question does reduce. So the RV structure is distal if and only if both K and gamma are okay, distal or has a distal expansion. If both K and gamma do. So okay, so now how does one prove it? So it's actually non-trivial. So there are two cases. In the case when the residue field has characteristic zero, so then we have to consider this infinitely sorted RV structure as I just defined, right? Remember that RV bar is defined, is contains infinitely many sorts when the residue field has positive characteristic. But the important point is that in this case, every sort is actually algebraic over the previous one. So this case is treated by the lemma about distality, about algebraic closure, preservation of distality in finite covers that I discussed earlier. So treated by the finite covers preserve distality lemma.
But then
why is this the case?
Value group to be Archimedean.
No, I don't need anything. I just need of P, right? So we see that since the residue field is finite, we have here that this is like the fibers of this are finite. So this ACL preservation of distality lemma applies to this case. And the characteristic zero case requires completely different treatment. And so we know, okay, so in the characteristic zero case, we have the short exact sequence. And we know that this is a reduct. So RV is a reduct. Remember, RV is RV zero. Yeah. So it's a reduct of the direct product of K and gamma. But for questions of distality, it's not preserved under reducts. So even though it's possible to define it, well, at the level of the theory, right, we can always pass to a saturated extension where the where the sequence splits, and so it can be defined in the pair. So for example, concluding an IP from this would be easy. But for distality, actually, there's no direct way except for actually understanding definable sets in the RV structure or in short exact sequences more generally, okay? So we really have to understand definability in short exact sequences. And so this is a result of, I think, independent interest. So how do we view a short exact sequences structure? So assume we have, actually, let me switch to a new slide. So assume we have a short exact sequence of abelian groups. So we have A, B, C, zero. And moreover, we're going to assume that this sequence is pure. So it's pure short exact sequence of abelian groups. We denote the first map by I, the second map by nu. And what does pure mean here? So this means that I of A is a pure subgroup of B. Okay, so what does it mean? So it means that if we have some A in the image, in this subgroup, and the equation N X is equal to A has a solution in B, then it has a solution in I of A as well, or iota of A. Yeah, so, okay, for general groups, this means if you have a root in of an element in the subgroup, in the big group, then you already have nth root in the small subgroup. Okay, so this is a first order theory. So viewed as a three sorted structure, with the corresponding maps given by the function symbols. We can write, of course, the axioms expression that this is a pure short exact sequence. And we would like to obtain a relative quantifier elimination where we know the definable subsets of A and C, and we want to understand the definable subsets of B or of all three sorts in terms of the subsets just of A and C alone, right? As you would want, I mean, you want to analyze B in terms of A and C. So we want, so we have a relative quantifier elimination, but something has to be added. So some sort has to be added. So we need to add, to obtain quantifier elimination, we need to add the following sorts. So we need to add A mod NA, and we need to add, so we add sorts for this, for all N. We also add the projection maps from A to A mod NA. But this is not all. We also need to add some additional functions from B to these quotients. So what we want from these functions, so the role of this, we basically want to imitate, okay, let me just say it, okay, algebraically. So how do we define this, this map through N? So on the pre-image of NC, this is the composition of the following group morphisms. So we have the pre-image. So it's equal to NB plus I of A. This maps to NB plus I of A mod NB, which is isomorphic to I of A mod NB intersection I of A, which in turn is isomorphic to A mod NA, okay? And outside of outside of the preimage of NC, we define it to be zero. Okay, so what is the point of these maps? So they note that we have pi n is equal to the composition of rho n with I. So the idea is to somehow add this this kind of maps, right? So if the sequence, if our sequence splits, then we would have the left inverse of I in this sequence, right? We would have a morphism going in the opposite direction So in the splitting case, let's say we have some pi prime. So if it existed, then we would have, so if our short exact sequence splits and pi prime is the section, then we would have that rho n is equal to pi n composed with pi prime on the preimage, yeah, where it makes sense. So the idea is to imitate these maps, but without having splitting necessarily. So then they can be defined explicitly by this sequence of morphisms. Okay. And now this is all we need. So in this language, we have a relative quantifier elimination. So let me state it. So we denote by LAC the language of, so the group language on A and on C. With arbitrary additional structure. Okay, so we can add any relations we want, which only live on A, on the A on A times C, yeah. So either on A separately or on C separately, but in fact we can add anything we want on top of A and C. So these two sorts, not involving B. Okay. And also we let B LB be the group language on B. So just the group operations, yeah, on B. So now the quantifier elimination, the relative quantifier elimination, says that modulo the theory of pure short exact sequences in this multi-sorted language with the quotients added as sorts, we have that every formula phi of xa, xb, xc, where these are the tuples of variables corresponding to the sorts a, b, and c respectively, yeah? So we have a formula like this. Every such formula is equivalent to some formula of the form phi prime of xa, sigma 1 of xb, sigma m of xb, xc, where we have that phi prime is a formula in the language LAC together with this only maps that we have, so pi 0, pi 1, etc. Right? So phi is a formula which only talks about A and C. And this sigma I of XB are special terms. So these are terms of the form rho n of T of XB or mu of T of XB, where T is just an LB term. So a term in the group language on B. Okay, so it's a strong way to say that we have uniform quantifier elimination down to the groups A and C. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So this is the desired quantifier elimination. A couple of comments about this is that, okay, first of all, it generalizes to modules or even to abelian structures. But we for our theorem, for this proof, we only need the case of abelian groups, well, with extra structure possibly. Now the purity assumption is automatically satisfied in the case of an RV sort, right? Because gamma is torsion free. Every torsion free, as long as C is torsion free, it's automatically pure. What else? Oh yeah. So before we actually had the result with Pierre. In the paper about INP minimality for Hinzelian valid fields, where we showed this similar quantifier elimination under the assumption that all the sorts A mod NA are finite, but this is a completely general. So nothing else is assumed, yeah? Okay, and it has some other application also to quantify elimination in Hinsilian characteristic zero fields, directly down to K and to the residue field and the value group bypassing the RV sorts. But anyway, so all of that is in the paper, if you are curious. The point now is that, again, using this relative quantifier elimination, we can obtain the result that we wanted. So we can show that we have this reduction, that distality or distal expansions of the RV sort reduced to K and gamma. By direct analysis with indiscernible sequences using this quantifier elimination. Okay. One last remark. So if we go back to the main theorem, here we're assuming that both K and gamma are distal, right? So for an IP, let's say, the assumption on gamma is not needed because all ordered abelian groups are automatically an IP, right? So this is not the case for distality. So distality in OAX. It's actually open. So we don't have a full characterization of distality in ordered abelian groups. What we know is that in the special case, so let's say G be a strongly dependent ordered abelian group, or more generally, the certain auxiliary sorts are finite in the quantifier elimination result of Clackers-Holub-Chok, let's say, but for specificity, let's just say strongly dependent, then we have that G is distal, if and only if G is DP-minimal, DP-minimal, if and only if G is non-singular, meaning that G mod PG is finite for all prime P. Okay, so at least among such, we know which ones are distal, but we conjecture that all ordered abelian groups have distal expansions. Okay, so this is open. So potentially for the question of existence of distal expansions, the part about gamma in the main theorem can be dropped. The assumption, on, maybe we don't need any assumption on gamma for the question of existence of distal expansions. Okay, but we need to state it, I mean, for now. Okay, so let me stop here. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Artem. Are there any questions?
Just the last statement about OAG, you mean the pure group has to be DP minimal or
are you working in? No, order. So gamma with, yeah. With ordering, yeah.
No, but I mean the pure order group or you allow additional.
Oh, sorry, pure, yes, just in the.
In the yeah. Pure order, yeah, okay, fine.
Your order group language. Yeah. Okay, if I may, I can make a general comment also about the conjectural classification. So so far we have this Axkochen-Yershov type reduction, right, for Hinsilian distal fields. But what about the just general distal fields or general distal, fields with distal expansions, yeah? So what are they? Can we deduce some classification from Scheler's conjecture, for example? So and there's yeah one can say something, but yeah okay. So maybe I shouldn't go into the details of this. So let me just remark this that Scheler conjecture plus this conjecture about ordered abelian groups all having distal expansions together imply that. And an IP field, pure field now, K, yeah, is distal if and only if, has a distal expansion actually. For distal, it seems much more complicated. So has a distal expansion if and only if K has a Hinsilian valuation with a residue field ACF 0 RCF of finite. If and only if K doesn't interpret an infinite field of positive characteristic. Okay, this is a funny statement because in fact we don't know that many theories, let's say NIP theories, which don't have distal expansions. Actually, most of them seem to have. The only reason until recently was defining an infinite field of positive characteristic. Actually, there is now a new reason given by some combinatorialists. So there are now certain expander graphs which are stable, but they don't have distal expansion, so-called Ramanujan graphs, if you know what that is. So you can also forbid having distal expansions without fields. But but here within the NIP context of NIP fields itself, the only way to not have distal expansion seems to be defining an infinite field of positive characteristic.
Are there any further questions?
Can you repeat the name of the graphs?
Ramanujan graphs.
Okay. Fine.
Yeah, so this failure of distality is combinatorial, at least, or strong Kardashev-Heinel, it seems to be connected to a certain, to being able to embed expander graphs in a certain regime. And like, for example, yeah, for Ramanujan graphs, it works. So this is a result. I don't remember all the authors at the moment. So it's it includes Nesetril, Asonia Mendes, and I think some other further co-authors who I don't remember on the spot, but if I can send you a link if you want.
Wait, so for DP minimal, you do know the left side?
For DP minimal, we know the right side. And yeah,
the left
both
side.
We know both sides, yeah.
Does having a distal expansion, is this a property of the theory or of a particular model?
So of a theory, yeah. As I said in the beginning, at least in this talk, for me, having distal expansion is a property of a theory. So it means that there is some other, it's actually not clear how, the question of this specific structure having a distal expansion is not so clear to me. Like, it's certainly easier to have a distal expansion for the theory rather than for this particular model of the theory. And presumably it's not always, presumably there's actually different notions. But I don't know any example of that, but everything is at the level of the theory, yeah.
And it's probably the same direction. You have a candidate condition, the model theory characterization for having a distal expansion.
The point that you see, it's not really a good property, like of really having a distal expansion. It's somehow not a rigid property. It's not like a model theoretic property. There is something called local distality, which tells you that somehow, which tries to do exactly that, to isolate the combinatorial conditions on definable sets, which capture the idea that there is a distal expansion. So there's some candidate, but I don't think there is like a reasonable actual characterization of having a distal expansion. But we have a combinatorial condition, local distality, which captures at least combinatorially all the consequences of having a distal expansion. But it's hard to imagine a bit to have actual characterization. So far, all the examples where we know, like, it seems more like art rather than science, you know, finding distal expansions. You really need to come up with something. But
it could be characterized in the Scheler expansion, though.
Scheler expansion preserves distality. So this we know, this is known. I mean, this. In fact, it's like I said, distality is not closed under redux, right? So there is a subtlety here. There's a result of Kästner, of Boxall Kästner. which shows that T, well, okay, so M is distal, if and only if M Shelah is distal. But the funny part is that the non-trivial direction is actually to show that if you have if you don't add all externally definable sets, because it's easy to show that if you add all externally definable sets, starting with a distal structure, you still get a distal structure. But what's non-trivial is actually to show that if you add just some externally definable sets, that is still distal. Somehow this the intermediate structures create a non-triviality here, and then but they show that it's still true.
Okay, so if there are no more questions or comments, let's thank again Artem. We will resume in 2 weeks. Christian Delby is our next speaker, and there will be more speakers starting January, and the schedule will be announced in the website shortly. So thank you everyone for coming.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome.